The Never Gets Old Podcast, the podcast of all we love in TV, movies, music, and comics, with your hosts, Mac Jackson and Nick Narrow. Look for us on YouTube and Facebook.
Hi, and welcome to the third episode of Never Gets Old. I'm Mac Jackson.
I'm Nick Narrow.
I'm Brian Bonner.
And today, we're going to keep it pretty loose. We're lucky enough to have Brian with us again. We wanted to discuss some of the comics that we're currently reading and enjoying. Nick, why don't you go first? What are you liking?
Well, this past week, I really liked the new Ninja Turtles. I think that came out this past week was really good. I know what I forgot to talk about when we were talking about our favorite books like 2 weeks ago or however long ago it is now. Scarlet Spider. I don't know if you're reading it or not,
No.
If you're reading it, Brian, but it's awesome. I love that book, and I forgot when we were talking about it, but then I got my books this past week, and it was in there, and oh, man, you have to catch up on it, because you'd love it. It's just that...
Really? Like, tell me about it. What's the premise?
Okay, so what happened during Grim Hunt... It actually comes out of Grim Hunt... in The Amazing Spider-Man, and also Spider Island, I guess.
Yeah,
Spider Island. One of Peter Parker's clones, Kane, I guess Parker. I don't know if he has a different last name. I think he's just Kane Parker.
Yeah.
He was killed during Grim Hunt by Kraven, who thought he was actually Peter. They killed Peter to raise Kraven from the dead. I believe. I think you just read it a little bit more recently than I did.
Yeah,
I read that. I read that one too.
So he was dead, and then the Jackal and the Queen Spider—I forget what her name is—they raised him from the dead and turned him into this big, like, tarantula, like he was an actual spider monster during Spider Island. And when they created the cure for Spider Island from Anti-Venom.
Awesome character.
Who is an awesome character. Anything with Eddie Brock. I mean, okay. But anyway,
right.
I digress. He fell into the vat of the Anti-Venom cure and turned back into the regular person, but still had the spider powers. And a couple different ones than Peter Parker has. So when Spider Island was all said and done, Peter and Kane, I think Peter wanted him to stay and work with him in New York, but Kane just, he didn't want to be around. So he stole one of Spider-Man's costumes. I think he stole the Future Foundation one, but I'm not sure. And hit the road. He ended up in, and that's where this new one starts. He's on the road, running. And he keeps ending up getting involved in these, like, crimes. And not that he's causing them, he's stopping them. But he doesn't even want to be a hero. He kind of just wants to be left alone. Like, like the Hulk, I guess. But he's a Spider-Man version of the Hulk. But he ends up doing the right thing, ultimately. Even though he's like, I don't want to do this. You know, this sucks. He's kind of an anti-hero, but not really. He's not, like, Punisher anti-hero or, you know, a really bad guy anti-hero. He's
kind of like in between.
He's Peter Parker.
He's a reluctant hero.
He's Peter Parker if Peter Parker was more cynical than just sarcastic and goofy. I mean, because he is a clone of Peter Parker. So he ends up in Houston and becomes like Houston's Spider-Man. And they start calling him the Scarlet Spider, which he hates. But he takes off his mask all the time. Like, people see who he is. And right now, he's in the middle of an Assassin's Guild war that he's related to in some way. I must go back a couple of years because I've never read anything about it. But it's interesting and it's fun. It's like fast and funny and just cool. I don't know. I really do like it though. But that was probably my favorite thing I read this week, besides like the Avengers X-Men versus was a lot of fun because it was Daredevil versus Elektra and Thor versus Emma Frost. I thought that those were both handled pretty well.
I don't think it was Elektra.
I'm sorry. It was Psylocke. Yeah, Psylocke. Eh. He makes reference to her being like Elektra in the book, and I think that's where I got confused. So,
It's in my pile. I just haven't gotten to that yet.
It's good. The artwork is really good in that. In the verses, that is. Because I'm trying to keep the
sweet
away from you. What about you? Did you read anything? What was the most recent thing that you read? Because I know you're a little behind.
Yeah, which kills me too, because it's funny. It's just, I realize why I'm behind by maybe a month, but I jumped ahead to catch up with the big surprise in Batman 10.
Okay.
There's the big reveal, so
yeah,
I got to read that, and that is, I know we've talked about it. That has been just holy, on every level, just an excellent book.
Well, you didn't read 11 yet,
the
right?
Art. I didn't read 11.
Okay, then
I only can't
talk to you about it. There's even more surprise at 11.
The Batman Annual.
Okay.
I got with Mr. Freeze, which I thought was excellent.
I didn't pick that up. Was it good?
I recommend it.
Okay.
They basically do his origin.
Okay.
And they tweak some stuff, which I'm always afraid of, because I always liked the way that they, ever since the animated series where they gave him a definitive origin, I thought, all right, don't mess with that. But the way that they tweak this is very, very good. But, yeah, the Batman book has been absolutely fantastic. Also, let me see. I don't know. Let me ask you, should I mention specifics? I mean, at this point, if they haven't read it, I don't know if it'd be a spoiler.
Yeah, because I think at this point, it's at least going to be 2 weeks out from...
issue 10.
Yeah. It's issue 11 came out this past week. So,
all right, so I can actually say...
If that gives our listeners any idea of when we record this,
All right, so here's a spoiler.
Yeah.
Well,
wait, hold on.
We find out.
Hold on, Matt.
Okay.
Is it okay to spoil it for Brian? Are you reading Batman? Or
it doesn't matter. That's
okay.
Fine.
All right. I don't want to ruin it on him if he wants to read it.
If you haven't read it, Brian, please, do yourself a favor. The big reveal of one of the bad guys is Thomas Wayne Jr.
Hmm.
Turns out Batman had a younger brother he didn't even know he had.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Oh, and they do it so well. I mean, that like I said, everything on that, from the art to the story,
yeah,
to the pacing, to the creation of new characters, I get chills. It's always the last thing in my pile that I read.
It's always, right? It's really well done. And concurrently with the past couple issues, I think since 8 up until 10, they've been doing a couple pages at the end of each book with the story of Alfred's father and his relationship to the whole Court of Owls thing, which is very interesting. Yeah, it's mm-hmm. it's pretty, and it delves into the Wayne history and stuff. And I kind of like that, because I mean, I don't know how much they've ever done of like the Bruce Wayne's history and his like family and the people who came before him, but
it's been pretty sporadic. I mean, it's out there, but it's, you know, I can't tell you a specific line of books, you know what I mean?
But in this run, since the New 52, they've been doing a lot more of, like, the Wayne legacy. And not just the future of the Wayne legacy with all of Batman's, you know, boy fighters and whatever, but his parents and stuff before that. So I thought it was all very interesting to read and learn that history.
Well, I'll tell you the other one, as far as independent goes, I don't know if either of you read it, but it's called Lil Depressed Boy.
No,
I've seen it, though, but I haven't read it.
No.
I've really over the years gotten more into the slice of life movies, slice of life comics. It doesn't always have to be superheroes.
Okay.
And this is a book where, I don't know, how would you explain it? They draw him to be, from what my understanding is, not specific with features, which I take as it's supposed to be anybody.
Okay.
Because he just looks like a plain rag doll. I mean, he doesn't even have fingers. But the story, the pacing, it feels like nothing necessarily happens. But that's okay.
You hooked me.
Like the yeah. honest to God,
he's
got
playing.
Such a
he's
charm
a rag
to
doll.
It,
he has
despite
no hands.
The fact that it doesn't feel like anything happens.
Every page is blank.
Well, no, I mean,
you
but they'll have him sitting in the car waiting for his friend to get back in the car.
Okay.
And it'll show him, put his iPod in, the earplugs into his ear, and he'll listen to music for a panel or two, and then he'll get done with that, maybe eat a candy bar, and then his friend comes back out into the car, and then they have a conversation, and then they start down the road. There's a charm to it, despite the fact that it's not action-packed.
Yeah.
I find myself really, really appreciating it. He now currently has a job in a movie theater.
Okay.
Because he needs some money, so he gets a job, and you see him cleaning up the theater before the next crowd of people come in. He takes out the garbage. There's a girl that he's flirtatious with, so you want to see where that goes. But like last night, I went to go see The Amazing Spider-Man, and I'm sitting in the theater waiting for my wife to show up because I was meeting her there, and that's what went through my head. I'm like, huh, Little Depressed Boy works in a movie theater.
It sounds about as fun as watching somebody play The Sims.
Wow.
And yet I'm still buying it.
I'm sure it's better than that.
Yeah, like I said, you appreciate the independence of it. It's the art's charm, the story has a sweet pacing to it. I enjoy the journey, I guess, is really what it comes down to.
All right.
So there's two different a spectrum for me. There's the action-packed, absolute, holy crap, you got to read Batman. And then the subtle, quiet, because ever since Why the Last Man, I've been aching for that type of quiet, most of the time, quiet type of journey book.
Did you... I just want to ask real quick, did you collect Why the Last Man as it was coming out, or did you just get it in trades?
No, I remember the store I was at, my buddy lent me the first three issues because I didn't get it right from the beginning. I didn't know what it was. I didn't, want to spend the money if it wasn't going to be any good.
Mm-hmm.
And from there I was hooked, and then I read every issue and got every issue up until the end, and it killed me when it ended.
Mm.
One of the most one of the best endings to a book, and not everybody has a happy ending, but it's emotional.
Yeah, it was. I Mara has them all in trade, my girlfriend, and she kept pushing me to read them, and I had them in my room, and I was reading comics week to week, and I just kept putting it off, and I was like, I don't know. And then eventually, I forget what made me pick it up, but I picked up the first trade, and instantly, I was like flying through it, and I loved it. Everything about it was like smart and cool and interesting, and I loved the ending. And I've talked to other people who were disappointed with the ending, but I thought the ending was was good. I mean,
it's very gutsy too. Yeah, I mean,
that's why I like
Vaughn. Vaughn has one of those. I noticed it too with this new series Saga. He's got a great pacing to the way that he writes, and he also is gutsy enough to say, "No, I'm ending it this way because this is the way I see it,"
mm-hmm.
with the understanding that not everybody's gonna love it.
Right.
You know, you got to respect him for that.
Mm-hmm. Well, some people have.
I think
those...
overall.
Go ahead.
It paid justice to the whole series.
Yeah. And I mean, some people, they have those stories in mind, you know, a story. That's it. I know Brubaker does that with his independent stuff, like Criminal and Incognito. And like, he has one story to tell, and he tells it and then moves to the next thing. And it's pretty prevalent in anime and manga. And I know Brian reads a lot more than I have, but they don't go on forever. There's like only a few that go on for a really long time, mm-hmm. right?
Mm-hmm.
And that's how they like to tell their stories. And it has an ending, whether you like it or not. It's going to end.
Chew, and
that's it.
Chew is one of those.
Chew
ends. Chew started off with, you know, I love Kirkman, and I love The Walking Dead, the writer says. And I have this planned out for, I don't know, 60 issues. But then I'm sorry to tell you, that's it. I'm done.
Okay.
Hmm.
You know, Lost was the first TV show where they said, no, we have a specific story to tell, and we're only going to do that story. I love that they didn't let the network talk them into dragging it out longer.
Right. I know.
Go ahead.
I think I talked about on the first episode that I like comics because they keep going and you can invest all that time. And I do. Don't get me wrong, I do like the fact that I can keep reading and stuff, but there's nothing better than a good story with a good ending too. I'm not averse to that. And the ending to Why the Last Man I thought was really good. And there's a couple other stories that I really like their endings for. And maybe I should make that into a question, but I guess I'll just talk about it now. Death Note is a manga that I read that I thought was awesome. And the ending to that was good. I don't know if I completely agreed with it, and I don't know if you read it or if Ryan read it at all, but...
A little bit, not the whole thing.
Okay, well, the ending is good, and I would highly suggest both of you read all of it because it's a really smart, good story, so...
Do you have a copy of it?
It's actually a bunch of volumes. It's like 13 volumes. Little like paperback sized books. And I don't have them. I think Mara has them, but I'm sure I could swipe them from her and let you borrow them.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
as soon as I catch up with my pile, yeah, please, definitely. Yeah. I would love.
I'll just give you one at a time, but you'll get invested. It's good. It's something you might end up wanting to buy for yourself when it's all said and done because I think it's that good.
Right.
Yeah, it's definitely one of the better mangas.
It's more accessible, I feel, because Brian reads One Piece, and he likes it a lot, and I've read a little bit of it, but it's harder for me to get into, and maybe I might try it again, because I started reading it right after Death Note, and they're just so wildly different that I felt like it was harder for me to get into, because One Piece was a little bit more cartoony.
Well, it's more comedy adventure. Mm-hmm. Like, now when I say comedy, I mean, you're not going to laugh at every single page, but it's more of a humorous, manga or comic as opposed to other ones.
Yeah.
And it's ultimately it's an adventure comic. I fell in love with it. I mean, I hate to say this, but unfortunately the four kids version of One Piece is actually the one that got me into it. I don't know how, because after I watched the Funimation version, and I'm like, wow, 4Kids did a terrible job of, quote, Americanizing it. So, like, I'm thankful for 4Kids for getting me into it, But at the same time, I'm like, wow, you guys did a terrible job.
But yeah, so, I mean, Death Note is like a serious drama that's not almost, well, not really ridiculous. I mean, there's fantasy elements to it, but it's not, like, you know, goofy. And sure. One Piece is a little bit more goofy. So I'm going to give it another shot now that I'm far enough removed from Death Note to maybe take it in a little bit better. But So I like stories. I do like good endings to stories anyway.
Well, Terry Moore, originally with his Strangers in Paradise, mm-hmm. I wasn't crazy about years ago when a buddy of mine bought me one of the trades. It was good, but this is back in, say, 92, I'm guessing. I was all in about superheroes at the time. But now that I'm at the age and the years of reading, I've really come to appreciate the independent books more. Mm-hmm. And I have to go back and give those that series another shot, because his other two, the one that was a limited one, Echo. I don't know if you've read Echo.
No,
read it. It's limited. His art is amazing. His pacing is brilliant. And it also has a beginning and an end. And he has another one that he's doing now called is it Rising Rachel? Or Raising Rachel? I have to look at the... What is it?
I don't know.
We didn't.
I have no idea.
We have no idea.
It's also fantastic. It's this girl who wakes up in a ditch. And apparently she was killed. Her eyes are bloodshot. She's got the rope marks around her neck. She has no memory of what happened. Oh, it's fantastic. He also has a limited run on that, apparently. He's going to end that at some point. Because I just read at the Comic-Con where he said he's going to, after this is done, I'm going to do, I don't know, something lighthearted, I guess.
You read some so very interesting stuff, Mac.
Yeah.
What?
You read some very interesting stuff.
Well, thanks. I try to,
Depressed boy with
like
no
I said,
hands.
That's the problem with my comic order every week. It's
girl lying
it's
in
so
ditch.
Freaking huge.
Yeah.
Well, we were at the shop on Wednesday, and I thought I was spending a lot, and Max bill came to, what, $74 and change or something like that? For new stuff.
Yeah, I try
that
to
was
limit
just
myself
new
to
stuff,
$50
right?
a week, which, you know, shouldn't... The last couple weeks, it hadn't even hit that, and then this week with... Walking Dead 100 coming out, and just it was just one of those weeks.
Yeah.
Because I'm reading so many independent books now. Yeah, 74 ish, and everybody in the store went.
Yeah.
I'm like, yeah.
It was a big week for me too. Like I was 51 something or whatever, and I was like, I didn't even think it was going to be that much. I knew I had a lot of books, but I guess there were a lot of $3.99 books as opposed to $2.99. So it was, but yeah, your pile was impressive. I could see why you're behind, but still.
Thank you.
Yeah,
it's definitely not laziness on my end.
Well,
so
it's partial laziness.
Brian, huh?
It's partial laziness. If you wanted to read those books, you'd stay up all night and read those books.
That is true. I have had to make some hard decisions. Feed the kids or read my comic books.
Read the comics.
Yeah.
Kids
can fend for
themselves. So, Brian, what are you reading?
Well, let's see. There's a couple different things I'm reading. I'm behind on a number of them. Just the reason being just financially at the moment. But I do recommend, I thought Teen Titans is really good. It went into, The Culling and it did a crossover with, Teen Titans and, Superboy's kind of been a crossover for a number of issues.
And Legion.
Legion Lost and like, it was really good. I've always liked, you know, like the teen heroes. That was really good, and I highly recommend Earth 2. They're up to volume, I think, issue 3 now. I've only read the first two. I'm in love with it. I think it's great.
Yeah.
Have you guys read it at all?
No.
I'm at issue 1.
You were telling me about it, but
okay.
I didn't get around.
I just think it's so cool the way it's literally flip-flopped. It's, you know, reading comics, it's always like, you know, it's that the Justice Society was like the old school group, you know, like, you know, Wildcat and Dr. Fates and just like all those guys were like the old school. Well, now it's like the roles are reversed, you know, like, you know, something happened.
Batman, Superman, Wonder Woman came first. Yeah.
Right. And then something happened. And now it's like the Golden Age, the classic guys are the new guys. And it's just, it's well written. The last thing that I actually read was, it was an older 2002. It was a 4-part miniseries starring The Thing. And I believe it was called like something like Trouble on Yancey Street or something along those lines. And it was just The Thing. That was it. And it was just such a really good miniseries. Like I said, it's just a 4-part miniseries. It just involved him. You see the Fantastic Four a little bit, but it's dealing with Ben and his internal frustration with being the Thing and not being able to hide it and dealing with it and just walking down the streets. And it actually deals with him in relationships with, you know, he meets another girl and, you know, it just so happened that this girl was the Sandman's ex-girlfriend, sort of say.
Okay.
And so it's like, and like turmoil hits, and I forget what they're called, the Frightful Four, I believe. Sandman, not the Trapster. What the hell's his name?
Pace Pot Pete.
That
is the Trapster.
No, he's.
Was Wizard one of them?
No. The one guy had like glue guns.
That's the Trapster.
That
yeah.
Trapster.
It's Pacepot Pete, but he changed his name. So.
Yeah, so like,
thank
there's,
God.
There's him, Absorbing Man. Like it was, I don't know, it's just a really good miniseries. And then like Nick said before, like I'm really into One Piece. I like it because it's ongoing. Like right now they're on in America they're on volume like 63, and like Nick said, Death Note went what like 12.
Yeah, so like, 12 and then 13 is like appendices or something like that. But.
Yeah, like a typical manga goes from like, I don't know, like 15, 20, give or take. But like Dragon Ball Z goes forever. Naruto has been going on for a while. One Piece is huge. And right now they're on like 63. And I think the author and creator said he's maybe halfway done. So like that excites me because I love the story. I love the characters. I love how they're maturing and who they're becoming. And even though they're pirates, they're like I was telling Nick the other day, Luffy and his first mate, they're part of the new age of pirates.
For those who don't know anything about One Piece, it's a manga about about pirates, essentially.
It's a pirates adventure.
And Luffy is the main character.
And yes, Monkey D. Luffy is the captain of the Straw Hats. And there's a number of different pirates, pirate groups out there, and they all fly under their captain's flag. And all the flags are different, different themed. And each captain is themed. And there's things called devil fruits, where if you take a bite, you get one of the powers. And ultimately, you don't really know what power you're getting. And the drawback, if you eat the fruit, being a pirate, you can't swim. You eat the fruit, you sink to the bottom, and the water pretty much drains your power. You become weak. But there was the old age, you know, the old age of pirates. There's a huge catastrophe that happened. Older pirates died. Other people got injured. And now the dawn of the new age of pirates comes. And I just find it's just so cool because Luffy and his first mate are in the top 10 of the new age of pirates who have a bounty of, it's like, I think I want to say it's like 200 million berries or more. Berries would be like their dollars, sort of say. currency. The currency. 200 million berries or more. And in that top list, they're all different pirates. But in Luffy's case, it's Luffy and his first mate. Like, and what's kind of scary in the sense that they're that high, but they don't kill people. The people who are high with them are ruthless killing machines. That's why they have high bounties.
Yeah.
But Luffy has the second highest bounty of 300 million, and he doesn't kill people. Like, that's a dangerous man to be that high and not take anyone's life like that.
Right.
But, I mean, it's just such a really good story, and just the growth and the camaraderie and Luffy's unending optimism, no matter what's in front of him. He doesn't care. He'll conquer it. He'll defeat it. He'll get by it somehow with the help of his crew. Like I said, it's a really good manga to get into.
Now, why haven't I heard of that? I mean, is it that you said new issues are coming out, right?
Yeah. Volume 63 just came out in July. It's huge in Japan. Volume 61, 62 broke a record of, I believe it was like the first day of selling their volume, like in Japan, like it shattered a record with sales. It, like I said, it's huge. Like, it's such a huge manga, and it's popular in the States, but it's not as big as other ones.
I think the thing is, even though we read comics and stuff like that, we like this, you know, nerdy culture, or not that we like the nerd culture. We are the nerd culture.
If you say so.
Anime is, well, I mean, if you've been reading comics for that long, anime is its own world entirely that even we can miss, you know, like there's a mm-hmm. whole bunch of stuff that I have never even heard of. And I'm sure there's lots that are stuff, but you can miss it because it's not stuff that's going to come out in the comic shops. I mean, you have to go to the bookstores to find it, and that's probably only in recent years too, I would say.
Yeah.
Is that where you found it?
Like I said, 4Kids got me into it.
The cartoon.
Oddly enough, they got me into it, and then that kind of opened the door for me to manga and their form of comics, and then I started looking online and stuff, and I realized, oh, place like Borders, before it became Books a Million, would carry it, and that's, you know, that's kind of how I got into it, and mainly I've gotten them from you know, bookstores every once in a while, like Amazon or something. The only downfall with that, because it's a part of Shonen Jump, which is Shonen Jump has a magazine that comes out, I think it's weekly. That has, because within each volume, there's like X amount of chapters, maybe like 10 chapters or something within a volume. And then you get one chapter in that Shonen Jump magazine. And then within that Shonen Jump magazine, there's like 8 or 9 different stories. So like Yu-Gi-Oh! Will be in there. There's a basketball one, One Piece. So you have to wait for Shonen Jump to come out before you buy the volume. So for me to get the next One Piece volume, I have to wait another like 3 months.
Sure.
So that's the downfall. But yeah.
Huh. All right. Well, I know that we wanted to take turns asking questions, and Brian had a bunch of he had a good one last podcast. Would you start us off? And because I know you had a couple that you wanted to ask.
Yeah, I can start off. I mean, I guess I'm not sure if you want to do it in general or if you want to be specific with Marvel and DC, but
mm-hmm.
who would be like your top 5 heroes? Your top 5, almost like you're going to make a team of, I don't want to say a team, because you might have like 2 or 3 strong guys. Like, I'm not looking for the balance. I'm just looking for
who's our favorite.
Yeah, your favorites, pretty much. Like I said, I don't know if you guys wanted to do a combination, or if you just wanted to do a DC Marvel or just Marvel. It's up to you.
Let's,
I mean, if you're...
Let's keep it general.
You want to...
Okay.
Just general?
Yeah, go ahead, Nick.
Well, I mean, I think everybody at this point knows that my favorite hero is Indiana Jones.
No.
But,
really?
But, yeah, so, I mean, Indiana Jones is my top number one, and then number two is Steve Rogers.
No, I was thinking, I thought it would be, like, superhero.
Just superhero? If we're just going with superheroes, then, and they were going with five, it's gonna be, I think they're all Marvel then, probably. It's Captain America, Daredevil, Wolverine. I'm trying to look at my my shelves here. I love Nightcrawler, so he'd be like number four. And
I think there's always an X-Men in everyone's top five.
There is. Well, Wolverine and Nightcrawler. Hawkeye is number five for me. I've always liked Hawkeye. Yeah. It's not because the Avengers came out or anything like that. I don't know where or why. Maybe it's because of the purple. I said before, like, my favorite color is purple. And
right.
I do like bow and arrow, too. Like, I think that's an interesting weapon because you have to be really good to use it. And he obviously is really good. So, yeah, Hawkeye.
All right. How about you, Brian?
Well, I'm just gonna throw this out there since he started with Indiana Jones, but then we corrected it. I would have to say Jack Bauer would probably be on my team.
Yeah.
I'm 24. But superhero wise, Colossus is definitely one of my favorites. Venom. Well, I'll have to say the Eddie Brock Venom and Flash Thompson's version of Venom too.
Okay.
I really love both of them. Oh my God, my list can go on forever.
hey, this was your question.
Yeah,
buddy.
I know. I kind of digging my own hole here. Well, mine's scattered with DC and Marvel. With DC, I really like the Creeper. He's just such a cool character. And then Blue Beetle. I've always liked the Jaime Reyes version. I love all the Blue Beetles, but the Jaime Reyes one, like the newest Blue
sure.
Beetle. And I guess I'll throw in Better Ray Bill.
All right.
He's kind of like...
That's pretty...
Yeah. He's kind of like...
Pretty diverse.
And, like, for people who maybe... Who don't know Better Ray Bill, he's like... he's like almost like a mirror image of Thor, but he kind of looks like a decaying horse.
Yeah, essentially.
But he's such an awesome character.
You haven't seen the new season of Avengers yet, right? You haven't seen season two almost at all?
No.
There's an episode with Thor and Beta Ray Bill. It's essentially Beta Ray Bill's origin story is an episode, and it's good. I think you'll probably like it once it's on Netflix or whatever.
Nice.
Yeah, they actually make him cool in my eyes because I was never a fan, but I'm like, okay, this is good job. I appreciate the episode.
Well, they put him in Planet Hulk in that movie. I don't know if you saw that or not.
No.
He was actually in that, which it was a fun movie. It was really good. But yeah, Bettery Bill made an appearance in that too. That was really cool.
That's good.
Nice. Let me see. Boy, while you guys are talking, I'm trying to think of my top five.
Yeah.
Well, true. I mean, my first two are easy. Batman and then Daredevil.
Right.
It's funny because a lot of my favorites are the ones that are near and dear to my heart are in the Batman family, so I kind of feel like I'm cheating.
Yeah.
Because I think to say Batman kind of means, I like, I don't know. I tend to like all the offshoots. Like, I love Robin and Batgirl and Nightwing. I just love the whole mythology,
Mm-hmm.
So, let's see. For three, I'm going to say Nightwing.
Okay.
Even though I feel like I'm cheating, I mean, we can always revive. This isn't set in stone, but yeah, Nightwing I love. Robin then, too.
Which Robin?
Boy.
Are you saying Damian, or who are you going with?
No, because Damian, I enjoy his stories, but I'm still... Yeah, I he's like fence, the character right? I love to hate, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. I love him and you story, love to hate him.
Yeah. So let's see, Batman, Daredevil, Nightwing. Oh, God. See, I could easily say Tim Drake, Robin, and then Barbara Gordon, Batgirl. And that would wrap up my list. But okay. Boy, there's other heroes that are near and dear to my heart for reasons I still don't know. Like, I would say Green Arrow, I like.
Yeah.
Firestorm, even though I don't read the comic book, the original version of Firestorm, because I had the superpowers figure, I always thought he was a great-looking character. Iron Fist, you know.
Yeah.
For some reason, there are some characters that I just like. I don't know. I have a soft spot for them. No, so,
I'm the same way.
You understand what I mean?
Yeah, that's why it's hard to make this list. I mean, I could probably put them in a numbered order, but the list would just go on forever because I really do enjoy these characters. Iron Fist, too, you just said.
Yeah, I probably should have more rules to this question.
No, it's okay.
No, that was it's a good question because it gets us thinking.
Yeah.
So let's see, Batman, Daredevil, Nightwing, and Spider-Man too. But again, yeah. Spider-Man is one of those when he's written well. I always look at him like Sinatra. When he's good, he's great.
Mm-hmm.
When he's bad, he's atrocious. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And
yeah.
So it depends on the Spider-Man story. But, I mean, it's the same thing. Like, some people just love Superman. And I love the idea of Superman. But tell me the last good Superman story you've read.
The Death of Superman.
Oh, there you go.
Quiet. Don't start.
So, yeah, I don't know. After three, it kind of gets... Superman. Way too broad for me, but there's my answer, more or less.
I have a good question if you guys are up for it.
It's
related to what we were kind of talking about before, and I just thought about it because it's something I talk about every once in a while. And I'll go first so that I can give you a good example of what I'm shooting for. But we were talking about endings to stories and how, you know, whether we're happy or not with how some stories ended. And I have a very specific one that is upsets me. So the question is, are there any stories that you wish had ended before they did, had ended sooner than they did? Now, I'll answer it first because I just want to explain it a little bit and might give you guys a better idea. I thought the ending of Terminator 2 was brilliant. It was perfect, and it never needed to go any further than that. And Terminator 3 is like the worst movie I think they've ever made, and I hate it. I'm so mad that I've ever seen it. Now, the end of Terminator 2, it has that great voiceover with Linda Hamilton playing Sarah Connor, and she said, like, it's so positive and uplifting. She says something to the effect of, in the end, we did it. We changed the future. We fixed everything. You know, that's paraphrased, but it's such an uplifting, good ending. That's where it should have. That's it. That should have been it. The first movie in that movie and done. And then you get to Terminator 3, and at the very end, you have John Connor standing in this room
bunker.
Where Skynet. Yeah, the bunker, and he's like, oh. I guess at the end, we couldn't change anything. Everything sucks. You know, that's essentially what he says. That's his voiceover at the end.
Yeah.
And it's like, why didn't you just say you were going to show me Terminator 3 and then have, like, a weightlifter punch me in the face for 20 minutes instead? I'd feel better. Like, that's what I wish happened. But, I mean, and okay, Terminator Salvation, fine.
Mm-hmm.
That to show, like, what John Connor was doing the whole time while he sent the Terminator back. Fine, okay, that's okay. But otherwise, it should have just been Terminator 1, Terminator 2. That ending was awesome, amazing, after such a pretty good movie. That's what I wished for as an ending. So that's the question I'm asking a little bit.
Well, I didn't like the fact that, you know, for me, I was in the theater. I saw that in the theater. And when you see the missiles launch, I'm like, oh,
what's that?
Wow.
Two or three?
Three.
Yeah,
when
they actually show,
in the end, you didn't win. Like, the missiles are launched. That wasn't his mission after all. It was just to keep you alive.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay. I, that part of it I respect and like because it was shocking. I didn't see it coming. It was the payoff. However, I wholeheartedly agree with what you said. That whole message in the end of, well, life sucks and there's nothing we can do.
Mm-hmm.
Don't even bother trying, folks, because we're all up poop's creek.
Yeah. Well, the reason the reason I don't like it is because they essentially just did it to say, hey, just so you know, we're going to keep making more Terminator movies and this is why, you know, because nothing did get solved. Nothing got fixed, you know. And if they had done it well, if the movie was good, I might not have been that upset about it, but the movie itself was bad. The action scenes where we talked about it a couple weeks ago were just choppy and you couldn't see anything. It was just movement. It was like, all over the place. And I know no one could see what I just did, but I just waved my hands all over like a crazy person.
That was me for Daredevil, yeah.
Yeah. So, and that's what the movie is like. I don't think I need to explain it to any of our audience because they probably saw it and they're probably as angry as I am about it. But yeah, I mean, if the movie was better, it might have been okay. But that's essentially what they were saying, and that makes me mad. After such a good ending that I feel Terminator 2 had. So.
All right. Let me think. For me? Okay. If I can go on a bit of a rant. The first 8 seasons of Stargate SG-1, perfect.
Mm-hmm.
They're brilliant. The character development, I can spend hours talking about why and how great each cast member was and the writing. And, you know, it was very respectful. The show was never a cliche. One of the things Richard Dean Anderson said was, you know, you're not writing for cows. You can write, there's actually interviews which you can take clips from where he's saying you should be able to write up to the audience. You know, just because it's smart, you don't have to dumb it down for the audience to understand. I think that's one of the most vile things in the world. So he kept that standard. And for 8 years, the show was perfect. I got it. It built upon itself. The first season was good, but at the end of the season, they shake things up, and it just built on itself. The last 2 seasons of the show, I wish they were never made. In hindsight, I wish they were never made. I wish it ended at the end of the 8th season, because they had beaten all the bad guys that were set up. It ends with the understanding that, okay, Jack and Sam do love each other, even though they don't. The thing about in the show was they were military, so they couldn't have them officially get together because he was her commanding officer. And they would have the Air Force, somebody from the Air Force was a consultant on the show. And they'd say, sorry, you can't actually have them be together in these current military positions. But they had already established their feelings for each other. And, you know, so you knew that, okay, by the end of it, they better get them together officially. The end of that season, you get the illusion that, okay, they're going to. There's your happy ending. And then Richard Dean Anderson left the show to raise his daughter. Like I said before, I can't think of a better reason for leaving a successful franchise than for the sake of your family.
Right.
What happened after that was such a travesty to the perfect 8 years. The show fell apart the acting was always wonderful from the people who were there. However, the other people that they added, it got cliche. it got, less intelligent, I think is the nicest way I could say it. It conflicted with the mythology that had already been established. Again, I could spend hours talking about specific episodes. It got to the point where Cindy and I would watch each new episode of the ninth season and go, right there, that would never happen. Right there. Okay, now in this episode, that shouldn't happen. Not only because it conflicted with military protocol, but I can see Richard Dean Anderson's lack of influence behind the camera, as well as, the charm and fun in front of the camera.
Right.
It hurt a once brilliant franchise. And I remember people who, the two actors that they got were Ben Browder and Claudia Black, who were on Farscape together. And I never watched Farscape, but apparently it was a halfway decent show. When they came over onto Stargate, it didn't work. Ben Browder, a sweet guy, unfortunately cannot act. Can't act his way out of a paper bag. And Claudia Black, they wrote to be such an obnoxious, cliche. Basically, they're trying to make her like Catwoman, where she was always trying to steal something. And, she's on the team unofficially. But she's this mouthy little, apparently supposed to be sexy. I remember saying, okay, right there, Jack O'Neill would have shot her. I mean, I could tell, because had he been in the room, he would have said, okay, you get out of here. And they kept it. They always kept it very, you're dealing with our military today. They're not going to let her go over and sit on a senator's desk and get mouthy to him. It just wouldn't happen. So without getting further down the rabbit hole of why those last two seasons hurt the franchise, that's the one. At the end of the, funny too, because they had the option of having Richard Dean Anderson come back occasionally, and Robert Cooper, who I guess had taken full control over the show, and he's probably the one to blame for why it got so bad, he missed the opportunity. He said, we're doing our own thing. Really? So you're not going to bring the star back whenever you want him to help with your sagging ratings? And he's actually willing to do it at any point. They had him on two episodes during the 10th season. And at one point he says, he makes a reference to the fact that the 8th season should have been the last season. Because it ends with them all gone fishing. And he goes, yeah, fishing. Have it end with them fishing. It was great, because the audience was like nodding their head like, yep, in hindsight, that's how it should have ended.
Wow.
How about you, Brian?
I guess two examples always keep popping in my head. I don't know if this will answer the question that you asked directly. I know it is similar to it. But the third Spider-Man movie, not so much the way it ended, but there was so much I could have taken out of the movie to make it smoother. Like, I don't need to see Peter Parker with that, like, punk-like black hair that's a
disco
little bit...
Disco dancing down the street?
Yeah, like, I don't need to see that. There's no point. You take that out of the movie, it's fine. Like, you don't need that in the movie to understand anything. And I mean, don't get me wrong. I mean, I love the story of Venom, and I understand the symbiote is bonded to you. It slowly is taking control of you. Your attitude changes. I understand that. But for what they did, it was bad. Like it could have been a lot better than what it was.
Yeah. Well, I think the sad thing about the third Spider-Man movie is it opens in a way where you think, holy crap, they're going to do this right. You know, I understand that, in the comics, Peter got the symbiote from Secret Wars off-planet or whatever. But in the cartoon that we watched in Spider-Man the Animated Series, the symbiote came from a meteor, or, you know, Jameson's son
essentially Jameson,
brings it back with him unknowingly from space.
Right.
So, like, they had it come in, what, a little meteorite or something like that? And it was an actual alien thing, and that was, you know, that happened.
That's right, I think it crashed to Earth, as I recall.
What's that?
In the movie, they actually have it crash to Earth.
Yeah, in a meteor, right?
Yeah, I think
So you think, like, oh, wow, you know, this isn't going to be some another science experiment gone wrong, or however they were going to explain the symbiote. They're actually making it an alien, and then it's like, oh, cool. You know, you think it's going to go the right way, and then it kind of, you know. I don't hate the third Spider-Man movie as much as everybody else does, but it could have been way better.
Oh, yeah, and I'm not saying I hated it. I mean, I love the Spider-Man character. I've always loved Spider-Man, always will. It's just, there was just a lot I didn't like in the movie. Like,
right.
It could have been a lot better. Like, I mean, honestly, I always forget the actor's name. The guy who played Sandman, is it Thomas Hayden Church?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep.
He was awesome. I thought he's a great actor to begin with. And he was just one of those guys. He's like a Patrick Stewart. He was born for that role.
Mm-hmm.
For some reason, he fit it. He really looked like it. So, and like Topher Grace, I like him. I like him as an actor. I think he's fun. He's not Eddie Brock.
No.
There's just no way that he is Eddie Brock. But like I said, there's a lot of things that would have taken out.
Thomas Hayden Church could have been, the way that he got jacked up to be Sandman, he could have been Eddie Brock and pull it off.
Sure.
Yeah.
Because he got real bulky to be Sandman. Yeah. So he could have been, I think he could have been a good Eddie Brock, because there's not a whole lot of people that I would cast as Eddie Brock. That's a hard role to cast, I think.
Yeah.
Well, for me, it was one too many villains.
Yeah.
You already had Harry Osborn, who was going to wrap up his story. You had the Sandman. You didn't need Venom, but apparently, from what I understand, Sam Raimi was told by the movie people, like, no, you have to have Venom be in your movie, which, okay, fine, but then take out Sandman.
Yeah.
You know, it was too much going on in one movie that can only be, what, 2 hours or so.
Yeah, right. I think, I'm sure Sam Raimi probably...
It just hurt the quality.
I'm sure Sam Raimi was probably noted to death. If you're familiar with the lingo of movie making, that means that the studio hands you notes down as you're progressing a movie and tells you what to change and what not to change and what to add, and it's all mandated, like it has to be done and whatever. And I'm sure they probably forced three villains on him because it's Spider-Man 3, so you need three times the threat.
Right.
So there's that. But if that were the case, I would have, as Sam Raimi, I mean, I guess I'm playing armchair quarterback, but make it a two-parter. Make it, split it. Like, say, this is Spider-Man 3 Part 1, Spider-Man 3 Part 2. I know that wasn't in vogue at the time, and since Harry Potter did it, and now Twilight. Doing it, and, you know, The Hobbit's going to do it, and the only other thing that did it was Lord of the Rings, but still, it was one book per movie.
Yeah.
Make it two parts. Right. That movie, if it was stretched to a second part, I feel would have benefited greatly from having that time. Because you only see Venom.
Oh, I agree.
You only have Venom, Eddie Brock Venom, in the movie for about 10 minutes, I'm pretty sure, near the end. He gets it out of the church, kind of goes crazy, Spider-Man blows him up. He gets blown up, and it doesn't really blow him up. But
right. Makes him go away.
But my other example in the I loved the series of Angel. It was the Buffy spinoff, Buffy the Vampire Slayer spinoff. Character Angel, vampire from Buffy, went to L.A. had his own spinoff. The character moved from Sunnydale, went to L.A. and he had his own spinoff. I loved the series. I loved every season. The way it ended, it sucked because it was so, they left it open hugely.
Yep. Anticlimactic.
Because the whole, like, you know, Armageddon type thing that was happening, they stopped. That's how they ended it. And that was it. I was annoyed because it's like, there's no closure. like, there's no ending, and there was such a huge write-in, but I guess not enough to really do anything. Like, there was rumors, like, to do a movie and blah, 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 but that's where the comic picked up. And I got into the comic a little bit, and it's not bad, but I like the show more or better than the comic, but just the way it ended, I wish it kept going, or I wish there was closure.
Well, you might get it anyway, because Joss Whedon, who did Buffy, right? He did Buffy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I mean, he's going to be one of those guys who has the power of, like, Cameron or Spielberg now, because he pretty much just made the, like, highest grossing movie of all time now. Yeah. Maybe not the highest grossing of all time, but in the time period he had it, he's going to have that power now. People are going to listen to him, and that's awesome because he knows how to tell a story very well.
Right.
And respect the source material. You know, based on Serenity and Firefly and all that stuff, and I hope he gets the chance to revisit some of those properties that never really got their just send-offs, you know, and
I agree.
Be able to go back to them and do a little bit of justice to them, so maybe he will.
Wouldn't it be excellent if, like, we got to see a new Firefly series?
Yeah.
That'd be cool.
Oh, man, I got into it just a couple years ago. Somebody lent me the season, and then I I rented the movie, and now I own both the season and the movie. Wow, it's such promise. It was so well done. It was smart. It wasn't cliche. I never knew what was going to happen.
Yeah.
And that'd be fantastic to get them all back together.
I only watched the movie. I saw the movie in theaters, actually, because I had a couple of friends in college who used to talk about Firefly. That's the name of the show, right?
Yeah.
Firefly is the show.
Yeah.
And say how
the movie.
Yeah. Say how good the show was, and I mean, at the time, I just didn't have the ability to go and watch it, with college and work and everything. But the movie came out, and they're like, "Yo, come see it. You'll definitely like it." And I did. I enjoyed it a lot. Because I like Nathan Fillion. I think he's, like, one of the coolest dudes. Most down to earth and likes all the same stuff we like. Yeah, just really cool guy, nice guy. Reminds me a little bit of Harrison Ford, but probably a little bit more outgoing than Mr. Ford is. So yeah, I mean, I'd love to watch the show. I think it's probably on Netflix, and if it's not, it probably will be again at some point.
I think it is.
It's only a couple seasons, right? So
it's not even it's one season.
Yeah. Really?
It's not even a whole season.
Oh man.
Yeah.
Yeah, the network basically didn't even show the pilot. They showed them out of order so that people who wanted to watch it didn't even know what they were watching.
Yeah, they kind of dropped the ball a little bit.
That sounds like they popped the ball, pooped on it, and then kicked it in the woods. So that's what it sounds like they did with that.
I don't know why your show didn't do well. I guess we'll have to just cancel it,
Yeah. We don't know what happened.
Let me ask mine.
Sure.
We're almost out of time. My question is,
We started at about 10 after, so we're okay.
Oh, we're good. What's a movie that you recently saw that got your attention?
That I recently saw?
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't have to be
in the theaters. It could be one that you rented or whatever.
Okay, I actually have a good answer for this. Both of you are probably gonna laugh instantly. But I just watched the other night Saturday Night Fever for the first time.
I'm just kidding.
Okay, so Saturday Night Fever, and I actually really liked it. I mean, I like the Bee Gees, mm-hmm. and I not that I love disco music, but I like their music.
It's so catchy.
The songs of the soundtrack I liked a lot, and the acting from Travolta was great. I mean, he's always good, but I mean, there's some nitpicks I had for the story, but other than that, I thought it was really well done for the time, and I liked it. Just kind of
the reason that it's so iconic. So you don't have to defend it. You're fine. You know.
It kind of just made me want to dance if I wasn't so tired at the time.
Mm-hmm.
But so that's that kind of grabbed my attention, because I felt like I want to do something that iconic. You know what I mean? Not that it inspired me to want to disco dance or like dance in any way, but it inspired me to want to make something with memorable characters and a memorable story, which I feel that that movie has. And it kind of got my juices flowing a little bit. So there's that.
How about you, Brian?
Just to touch base on the movie Nick just mentioned. It's funny, for my one movie class that I took when I was in college, that was one of the movies we had to watch. And I understand where Nick is coming from, and I understand how a lot of people really like that movie, but for some reason, I did not like it. I just couldn't get into it. A lot of the scenes, I mean, it's been a long time since I've actually seen it, but I don't know. I didn't care for it. A lot of the scenes I didn't like. I do like Travolta. I do like the Bee Gees. But I don't know. I just didn't care for it.
I think it's hard to relate to because, like, I don't relate to the characters in any way, shape, or form. But if you need to relate to characters, I don't think you're going to find it there unless you're from the city.
Yeah,
that's, like, you're that's an true. Inner city kid with not much Brooklyn, education and stuff like that. It's really hard to relate to. So I can understand why you probably wouldn't like it. I thought the dancing was phenomenal. Like, I'm not a dancer and I can't really dance unless I practice a lot. But he made it seem effortless. He was just so good. And
I'll give him that.
His acting is really on point in that movie. And that as an actor, I'm looking at that kind of stuff. To be able to throw away any sort of like reservations about, you know, roles or trying things, you know, he just kind of threw it all to the wind and got immersed in this character. And I liked it for that. Like I said, there's parts of the story that confuse me and aggravate me. Like, he essentially watches one of his best friends fall off a bridge and die, possibly on purpose. And then he just leaves his other friends, goes to this girl's house that is a bitch to him and says, I'm not going to see anybody ever again. I'm just going to live here now. And then the movie ends. It's weird. It doesn't make a whole lot of sense in some parts, but overall, I really liked it, for other parts that make more sense. But it was it was a movie in what, the 70s. They're not all, Apocalypse Now or anything like that. So
yeah, that's true.
What did you like, Brian?
Well, recently, I actually saw Disney Pixar's Brave, and I love Pixar. Mm-hmm. I mean, Disney's great. Disney does make some good movies and some not so great movies, but Pixar makes gold. You know, every time they do something, they do it really well, and I really feel Brave is one of those movies. It's definitely, in my opinion, it's definitely in the top, you know, the top, I guess, five of Pixar movies. Like, it was just really good. The animation was great. Actually, the animation was beautiful in some scenes where the characters are, you know, talking, interacting. The background and the scene that they're in, I swear to God, looked real. Like, it's amazing the technology and how far it's come with animation and computers and CGI. And I, like, you see the fireplace, it's roaring, and you see the old, you know, the, because it's set back in, like, old, I think it's kind of, it's Ireland.
Medieval?
Scotland?
Yeah, I think it's, like, Scotland. Kids. Yeah, it was, like, old Scotland and, like, the old bedposts and the old castle. And you see that, and you're just like, all right, is that real or is that computer? Like, it was just, the animation was that good. Voice work was great. The storyline was great. The ending, like, it was a really good movie. Like, I really enjoyed it, and I highly recommend it.
We were talking about stories a lot, and I think you said Pixar makes gold, and I agree with you, and that, I think, is 100% because John Lasseter knows how to tell a story. John Lasseter is the guy who's in charge of Pixar, obviously.
Right.
He's just a brilliant storyteller. And there's a lot of guys out there who are making movies who are really good at a portion of what they do, but they can't encompass it all. But John Lasseter can. There's only a couple directors who can do that, like know how to tell a story from all angles. And sure. I think that's why Pixar's as successful as they are. If they didn't have him, if he wasn't the guy in charge, I don't think they'd be half as successful as what they're doing.
Right.
Well, let me think. I can't really talk about the one that I saw last night because it's probably too soon, but I went and saw the new Spider-Man, the Amazing Spider-Man last night.
Yeah, I didn't see it yet. So.
What I can tell you is it was excellent.
Okay.
This is one that I originally saw the first trailer for, and I thought, meh, you're telling the origin story again because you have to see, you don't lose the rights, blah, 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 blah. I don't need to see an origin story. And you know what? As skeptical as I was, they won me over. They tweak it enough that you don't feel like you're watching the same thing again. I won't get into the details until you guys see it, but I will say it's excellent. As far as a movie that I saw recently that I can recommend, Another Earth. It's one of those weird slice of life, not big budget type of movie. That I've really grown to appreciate. And this is basically, it's a girl who goes to prison for accidentally, I think she was drinking, she wasn't paying attention, and she has a car crash. She kills this guy's family, his wife and child. Well, she goes to prison for it, and during that time, we find that there is another Earth. It's a parallel Earth up in space, and it's close. It I guess has come into our orbit. And this girl gets out of prison, and it's an odd parallel weird type story because on one hand you have that all going on where they're trying to make contact with that other Earth. Well, she is not doing anything with her life, and she goes to see the guy whose family she killed, and this guy's just a mess. I mean, who wouldn't be? And she wants to go and say she's sorry to him, but she doesn't know how. Meanwhile, you find out that this other Earth has other versions of us. So yeah, that's a heck of a twist, because the girl who makes radio contact through, you know, our government and is televising it live, it turns out, is talking to a duplicate of her. And so they're trying to figure out where the difference is. If it, you know, and they're going to plan, they're doing a lottery that besides the astronauts, one person gets to win a trip, or maybe a couple people get to win the lottery to go with them to this other Earth. And this girl wins it. And I won't say more, but it was really interesting. I mean, when it was over, Cindy and I looked at each other and said, okay, that was a good movie. That had that kept our interest. Yeah, so I, you know, that'd be my pick. I recommend that.
Okay.
It didn't get a lot of attention, but it doesn't make, you know, it was still a great movie.
When did it come out, and do you remember who's in it, actor-wise?
And it came out last year. Okay. Actually, the only person in it that I recognized was a guy, I can't think of the actor's name, but he was, have you both seen Lost?
Not really, no.
Sort of.
No. He was a guy who was the first of the others that they found among the, in Lost, when they start counting heads as to who was on the manifest of the plane. Mm-hmm. This guy looked like he was one of the survivors, and he's the first one that they discover. Oh, wait a minute! No, you're not. You're not one of us. Then where the heck did you come from? Great actor. I mean, brilliant acting. I love him in everything he's in. Well, he plays the father and husband of the family that died.
Okay. Hmm. Is it that older guy?
What do you mean older guy?
I don't know. Does he have like a shaved head? Sort of?
No. This is a character actor that if you saw him, you'd like him, but he's not necessarily a household name, but a brilliant actor. I believe the movie's called Another Earth, so yeah, check that out.
Okay.
All right, I think we are good on time.
Yeah, we're pretty good.
Let's see, anything you want to recommend before we go, personally?
I'm trying to think.
There's Flesh Eaters.
Well, yeah, it's still not ready yet, but it's getting there. So yeah, I mean, you can still check out the trailer on Vimeo or YouTube. Flesh Eaters, a love story. That's my jam.
It's definitely worth your 2 minutes.
Yeah, it's not even. It's like a minute 30 some seconds, minute 40 maybe. Give us some likes on the Facebook page, Flesh Eaters, a Love Story. And that's pretty much it.
That's yours. How about you, Brian?
Anything. Like I said, with comics, definitely recommend Earth 2. If you're into comics at all, or the DC, or superheroes in general, very good story. That's all I got.
Mm-hmm. All right. Let me see. What do I recommend? I can be pretty blatant and talk about go check out Harmony Constant, but that's that'll be on my bio page. So
yeah,
check that out. I have the MacGyver podcast to check out. Hopefully by the time this comes out, we'll have at least episode 2 and 3 out. First one's already there. I don't know, it's funny too, because I want to push, you know, my personal stuff, but at the same time, I figure if it's on our bio page, that's good, so I hesitate to do that. I always think about, you know, talk about comics or, you know, push for somebody else.
Yeah.
Actually, you know what, I'll tell you about the song that I picked for our podcast today.
Okay.
The song that I picked is Late Night Radio by David Gray. David Gray is one of my, you know, big favorites. And this is a great song. I can't see anybody who wouldn't like that. Usually with David Gray, you have to get used to his, I don't even know what it is that you have to get used to, because I adore the guy. And with his new albums, I still have to listen to it once or twice before I accept it, you know what I mean, subconsciously. But there's some songs that just grab you right away. And I think this has a great line. The guitar part throughout the whole song, I just learned it to play it myself. It gets you. It's catchy. Okay. You know, you'll tap your toe. It's called Late Night Radio. It's a lot of fun. So I guess that'll be my big pick.
Okay.
All right.
That's good.
All right. Well, thanks again to Brian for joining us.
Yeah, it's my pleasure. Again, had another great time.
All right. Well, I guess we'll see everybody next time we get to do one of these.
All righty.
Sounds good.
And as always, please send us your feedback.
Yeah.
Please promote it. By the time this is out, we'll have a Facebook page at least. Ask people to like it, you know.
If you like it.
Write in some questions. Right. Write in some questions, comments, you know, anything and everything. We're, you know, eager to hear from you.
Any comments, good or bad.
Right. We just won't show the bad ones. No.
I'll take all the bad ones and address them myself. With a punch in the face.
Dear scumfucker. Thanks for listening.
All right, everybody. That's it for us, though. So we'll see you next time on Never Gets Old. I'm Nick Narrow.
I'm Mac Jackson.
I'm Brian Bonner.
Take it easy, everybody.
Bye.
Later.
By the metal trap, she saw it all shine and swore in her mind she'd never go back. She don't mind the late night radio. She don't mind.
couldn't have dreamed the things that you see there on the avenue. She stared right into a million eyes that looked her right through, telling Red Joe the places she'd go and wiping the table clean. She got no idea the demon of fear or what a broken heart means. She don't mind the late night, late night. Walking a wall without a